These followers went to Nauvoo. Notice Strang never does. As they went to Nauvoo, they announced that James Strang was a new prophet, and the place that was being the new gathering place was Vory, Wisconsin. To give power to what they were saying, as hundreds now began to flock that way, in fact, most historians claim that James Strang's threat on the church was much greater than Sidney Rigdon's, even though James had never come to Nauvoo after his baptism. Now, amidst all this, James Strang now sent word to the Quorum of the Twelve that they were to come immediately to Vory, Wisconsin, and pay him tribute. You can imagine Brigham Young is not about to do it. And Brigham Young becomes upset, and so upset that there is a second trial against James Strang. It's held in Nauvoo. James Strang is excommunicated. When Strang hears that he has been turned over to the buffetings of Satan, James Strang holds a court on seven members of the Quorum of the Twelve in Vory, Wisconsin. He not only turns them over to the buffetings of Satan, but talks about that they will be as walking dead, and that when they die, that for generations yet unborn, children will walk by the graves of the dead, and that they will kick upon the graves and they will spit. Well, none of his threats had any effect on Brigham Young. In fact, James said, "Debate me as to who had the authority." Orson Hyde clamored back and said, "No one debated Judas Iscariot. No one debated Lucifer. We're not about to debate you." Well, how did James Strang get such a large following as one of the largest splinter groups? The answer was he announced that he had been given the plates of Laban. Now, the plates of Laban that he claimed he had were three small 10 kind of brass looking plates. Each one was about an inch and a half in height and about 2 3/4 inches in width. In other words, they're about, I don't know, if you had your car keys and chain kind of thing, maybe that kind of look. You wonder if they were so small, why Zoram needed to carry them, don't you? So he's got these three, and the miraculous part about the whole thing is that he's able to translate them in 5 days. And in his translation, he finds to his great amazement that they're better than the Ten Commandments, for they are the commandments Moses received before the Ten Commandments. So people are now curious. They're flocking. What's there in the brass plates? Eventually, James now moves his group to Beaver Island in the middle of Lake Michigan. It's the largest island there. As he moves them there, he concludes that he doesn't want to just be president, which he claims and calls himself president of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, but it is now time for him to be crowned king. Now, hearken back to his earlier journal writing when he's a young man, and that royalty was everything that he had wanted. Now, when James was finally crowned king, there were 300 there to witness his inauguration. And try and imagine a male standing 5'4", he's Caucasian, and in the Democracy Republic of the United States, did we ever have a king? And I'd say, yep, you ever heard of James Strang? Well, at his coronation, he was wearing a red flannel robe, to indicate a type of royalty. He had little white and black specks that went around his collar. He actually had a crown. He wore a star around his neck. This was to announce that he was a direct descendant from the house of David, rivaling Christ. He had a scepter. He had a sword. And once he was crowned king of Beaver Island, the congregation of 300 who had at one point been Latter-day Saints in Nauvoo, you wondered how they could have been so deceived. They now said, "Long live King James, King of Zion." Now, for King James, he had a really short reign. Part of it has to do with his rule of the saints. At first he called them brother and sister, which sounded much like you and I recognize the church, but it wasn't long until they were his subjects. He demanded that they pay tithing. If he didn't think it was a tenth of their increase, he would then send his missionaries into the home. They would then beat the people or steal from them. And you can imagine, this didn't go over very well. Not only did it not go over well, but James was finally gunned down in 1856. He was shot in the eye, he was shot part of the head, he was shot in the back of the neck, also in his back. He was shot right outside the general store while people just stood and watched. Then after he was shot, others joined in and beat him. So you'd say, well, wait a minute, does this church still exist? And I'd say, yep. As of this summer, the last person I talked to said there's now about 120. They still call themselves the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. They published the Book of Mormon in purple in honor of the royalty of James Strang. Now the question comes, are they true? After all, they're standing the test of time. Well, if Sidney Rigdon's needs a jump start, imagine what this one needs. It's not rolling fast. It's losing its membership. There's question all the time as to who will be the leader. And you definitely say, the roots, it's like a tree without roots. It's not going to survive. It's just a splinter. We now come to the third group that's still in existence today. Of the 18 different men that broke off and formed churches, one of them was the prophet's brother, William Smith. William Smith was angry at Brigham Young and basically concluded, what's a Young doing telling a Smith what to do? Brigham Young was angry, obviously, back at William Smith, who at one point had been a patriarch to the church and a member of the Quorum of the Twelve. William took a church and that he formed down to a place called Kentucky. His church only lasted a year. William himself concluded that he was president pro tem. In other words, he was only a temporary president until he concluded that the president who should rise up was Joseph Smith's oldest son, Joseph Smith III, who was 11 years old at the death of his father. So he's forming a church in 45 that's just waiting until what he views as the rightful heir to take over. Well, William Smith's church, as Brigham Young described it, it was so small that Brigham said, William is the president, he's his counselors, and he is also the Quorum of the Twelve. So what you've got is a really tiny church, but from that tiny church, you've got a seed for an idea. The idea is Joseph's son. Now, as that idea grew and mushroomed, we turn ourselves back to the Strangites. As Strang became king and began to literally push and force his views on his followers, one by one, they began to leave. Several of those early Strangites, by 1851, had fallen away from James Strang. They were in Wisconsin, some were in Iowa, some had even returned to Illinois. They began to meet in little groups that they called just the organization. They didn't really have a name for it, but they would talk about, remember those good old times when Joseph Smith the prophet walked the earth. And when there was authority and things seemed wonderful. As they met in those groups, it was small at first, no more than, well, obviously less than 100. Finally, by 1852, about three members of the Strangites, you get a Zenas Gurley, a Jason Briggs, you get a William Marks, and a few others, said, don't you think we should reorganize that old religion? And so they formed a group they called themselves the Reorganization. As they did so, they are for the most part made up of little clusters of people that were now fleeing from the cruel rule of James Strang. They had groups in Wisconsin and Iowa and even in Illinois. They just talked about the old times. However, as they formed this group, pretty soon they had a few members of a presidency. Some of the old Strangites were now made members of the Quorum of the Twelve. Some were even called on a mission. Where they went on a mission was to the various places that the splinter groups had gone, trying to bring them back. Some even went up to Beaver Island. Some went down to where Alpheus Cutler had a group there in Manti, Iowa. Others eventually went to Texas, where Lyman White was. Others went up to where Sidney Rigdon was in Pittsburgh, and so they began to fan out and to try and bring them together. As they did so, they do so with the idea, we're still waiting for Joseph Smith III.